Texas Podcast Massacre contains spoilers and adult language. For more horror, visit us at our website at texaspodcastmassacre.com. This is Texas Podcast Massacre.
Welcome to another episode of Texas Podcast Massacre, coming to you from Houston, Texas. I'm your host, Mitch, and with me, as always, is my fellow Wiki, Nate.
Why'd you spill your beans?
I'm just clumsy. They spill everywhere. So welcome to another episode of Texas Podcast Massacre, where each week we take a look at a horror movie and debate a horror-related topic with our unsuspecting victim, who is usually someone we would not consider a horror movie fan. This week,
we're trapped in the lighthouse, baby.
Yep.
We're trapped together. The only two people.
Yeah. Lisa and we had another unsuspecting guest lined up who was going to be their first show. They're supposed to relieve us. We've been here for 4 weeks and we are still here waiting at this lighthouse.
Like 130 weeks.
Okay, I've lost track of time. I have no sense of how long we've been here.
Exactly.
And you need to clean up the goddamn cistern.
No, I'm Willem Dafoe.
No. Not in hell no.
I'm the grizzled veteran, for sure.
Well, yeah, so this week we are talking about the brand new movie from Robert Eggers, The Lighthouse, which it's a little more new for some of us here since Nate has... held it over my head that he got.
No, I haven't. You held it over your own head. You're so bitter.
You helped me.
No. I'm very classy. You are very bitter about it and cannot let it go.
I was bitter.
Well, now you've seen the film. There you go. You happy?
Yeah. It's definitely something. I mean,
this is an uplifting film.
Yeah. So for those that don't obviously know, Robert Eggers did The Witch. So,
well, thanks for ruining all my stuff, but sure.
That's all your stuff.
All my stuff ruined.
Yeah. So that should already give you a sense of the kind of film and mood you're sort of walking into.
Yeah.
So yeah, we'll talk a little bit more about that. Yeah. Nate, let's get into a debate question.
I have come here to chew bubblegum and kick ass. And I'm all out of bubblegum.
So, Nate, you've seen this movie. You've had some time to think about
it. This is a two-hander.
This is really a two-man play
exactly.
Here. I mean, yes. There's nothing else. There's no one else. I mean, maybe a seagull.
There's a mermaid for a little bit.
Yes, that's the only...
Seagulls, I'm going to go in depth about the seagulls. Okay. They are great.
Yeah. So I guess without getting too much into the review, I mean, Willem Dafoe and Robert Pattinson are incredible in this movie.
Yes.
Hands down. I'm curious, though.
We'll get into it.
Are curious, though. Could you have recast this with anyone else and would it be better?
Yeah.
Well, not would it be, but recast it in.
Yeah, let's make an interesting
somehow
film.
Improve on this.
So it's the 1890s. Mm-hmm. You're trapped in a lighthouse. Essentially manning a lighthouse, no way off anyway, so you're trapped, like, ostensibly. Cleaning out shit. Seagulls are just taunting you.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the dudes is insane. So obviously Nick Cage is involved somehow here.
You see, I actually wasn't going to go Nick Cage.
I know, but I was thinking, like, Nick Cage sounds interesting here. Does the person have to be alive right now, or can I go back in time?
You can go back in time. Okay, sure.
I'd love to see Rucker Hauer as one of I'm going all previous episodes here.
Oh yeah, Rucker Hauer could be good.
If Rucker Hauer was in this,
well, okay. So we're talking about Willem Dafoe's character first. So you would pick Rucker Hauer.
Oh yeah.
Okay. See, I had a different approach. I thought. What about Adam West? Yeah, Adam West is crazy enough that I feel like, but not like so over the top crazy.
Sure.
Like, I feel like he could pull it off.
I was going to go the exact opposite direction. I was going to go Rucker Hauer and Kurt Russell.
Okay, so Kurt Russell is
the new guy. Yes.
Like young Kurt Russell?
Oh, yeah, very young
Kurt Russell. Okay, so we're talking like Roadhouse.
No, that's Patrick Swayze.
That's Patrick Swayze. Is that Patrick Swayze? Yeah, that's
what
right.
What is happening?
It's the tired.
Let's go Escape from New York.
Okay.
Yeah, right?
Yeah.
Let's go Escape from New York, the thing, time frame, a little younger.
Okay. So the mullet time.
Exactly. Sure. He's the young guy with the mullet. This one's a little more macho than this version.
Yeah.
But, oh my God, I would watch that for infinity.
Yeah, I'm honestly surprised you didn't go Shia LaBeouf. I really...
Oh my God. Wait, hold on a second. Hold on a second. Okay, Shia LaBeouf would absolutely be amazing at this. Okay, hold on. I'll do a second one. You do your main one here.
Well, Shia LaBeouf and Adam West were mine.
Wow. That doesn't make any sense. Okay.
Nothing in this movie makes sense, Nate. That's why it would work.
What if someone who talks really slow and someone who talks really fast? Like a big contrast. Who talks really slowly? Kevin from The Office and Reese.
No, fuck. Get Creed from The Office to be Willem Dafoe's character.
Okay, and then Busta Rhymes. If you want the fast talk. Oh my God. Busta Rhymes in a lighthouse.
Sean Connery maybe would have been.
Yeah, you have to go young. I mean, obviously younger. Yeah. Well, that's what I'm saying. Like, if I can go old school, like, I would go, like, you know, some of the classic actors.
It's your lantern now, dog.
Oh. Finding Forrester. Thanks for that. I would, you know, like Jimmy Stewart would be pretty great in this.
Would
he's
he?
Really squawky. He's out squawking the seagulls in this film. You like Jimmy Stewart?
I don't like him. God. I just
wow.
Oh my God. I just don't know that he would work in this. Says the guy who picked Adam West.
He was in Vertigo already. He's already used to being high up. It's totally fine. Adam West absolutely has no credibility in this. We're talking about awesome actors. You throw Adam West.
He's just he's up in the lighthouse wearing the bat suit.
You might as well just say, like, let's get James Vanderbeek and Chad Michael Murray in the lighthouse.
Hey, James Vanderbeek could
Oh my God.
Good handle up on Robert Pattinson's role, I think.
Okay, so James Vanderbeek is Robert Pattinson.
See, I think for Robert Pattinson...
Do you have to have an old and a young guy?
Well, okay.
Then mine doesn't work.
So you really got to get someone who's kind of the pretty boy. It can't be just an everyman. And then, and then you're right. You have to get someone super grizzled.
Okay, I got
to get
a little more grizzly. Okay.
Grizzly Adams.
Do you know Edward G. Robinson?
Yeah.
Okay. So Edward G. Robinson would You know that one fighter pilot character in Star Wars?
Mm-hmm.
There's like the really weird face.
Yeah.
That's what Edward G. Robinson looks like, but like for real. He's always the grizzled, hardboiled 1930s, 1940s guy getting the bad guys. He's the grizzled guy.
Ooh. You know, I'm just thinking this. Let's go back to the thing. Let's have Kurt Russell in there.
Yeah.
Wilford Brimley.
Oh, and Wilford Brimley? Wilford Brimley. Is Wilford Brimley agile enough? To be in the light. He's not climbing that ladder.
He can't.
No offense, Wilford.
He can't because his leg issues is from the diabetes.
Yeah, he can't. I think Busta Rhymes could make this work.
No, he couldn't. In no reality could Busta Rhymes.
Samuel Jackson and Busta Rhymes. Okay, now what are you thinking? Samuel Jackson would be really good as the Willem Dafoe character.
I think so. I think he could really.
Who's the young guy?
Oh,
Busta Rhymes isn't really that young anymore. So
no. Maybe you know who would be actually good if you're gonna go that route? Chance the Rapper.
Ooh, yeah. Chance is great. I don't know if he could really. This is a little intense. Like, you gotta be real good.
Yeah.
In this one.
Yeah.
You can't just be a werewolf in the movie for 3 seconds, like Slice or on SNL skits.
Yeah. That's fair.
Kanye. You know, put Kanye in this movie. He's already batshit insane. The camera's not even rolling. He's already murdering seagulls. So.
Yeah, no, you can't have that. Was that the seagull or was that Kanye? You be the
Who
judge.
Who knows?
No, all right, well, there's someone else I'm thinking that would be good.
What about Chadwick Boseman?
Yeah.
Chadwick Boseman and Samuel Jackson would actually be amazing together.
Actually, now that I've seen Dolomite Is My Name, instead of Samuel Jackson, Snipes.
Okay. Eddie Murphy could not pull this.
No, but Wesley Snipes I mean, I think Samuel Jackson's probably the better pick, but Wesley Snipes, I feel like, would bring a different
angle. Let's just do
angle.
Blade. You go Wesley Snipes and, was it Mahershala Ali?
Yeah.
Yeah, there you go. That'd be awesome.
No, you just bring Whistler back.
Oh, yeah. Chris Christopherson is so grizzled. He's so grizzled.
You know who I think actually could, in all seriousness, who could have done Robert Pattinson's role pretty well? Yeah. Pennywise.
Oh, Bill Skarsgård?
Yeah, Bill Skarsgård.
Okay, interesting.
Because I think he could certainly do that intensity. And then the fact that he just is so good at the facial manipulations. Yeah. Which so much of this movie is just Robert Pattinson's face.
Yeah.
You know, him being able to just do that, and you see
with the grain and the small aspect ratio, so you're 100% focused.
Yeah.
On their face. A lot of shadow work.
Yep.
Yeah, ooh, but he'd be cutting you. Like, the shadows on Bill Skarsgård's face could lacerate someone.
That's fair.
Wow, that would actually be pretty good. And then you get Tim Curry. See, you have to link it up. You have to link it up. Tim Curry would be amazing.
Tim Curry. Book that one. I think that's the winner. Tim Curry and Bill Skarsgård.
It's a lighthouse.
Oh, Christ. Well, if you have a better
It's a lighthouse.
Okay, no, then boo. I go
Italian on that.
I don't even know what to say.
That's the trailer.
I do want all the listeners to know that Nate did in true Italian form do the hand motion. So that's how you knew he's really speaking authentic. That's how you know it's authentic Italian. So
I'm about as authentic Italian as an Olive Garden.
That's about the level. If you've got a better
when you listen to our podcast, your family.
Yeah, this family style podcast.
All you can eat, baby. A lot of breadsticks coming at your way.
Yeah. So, yeah, soup. This is never ending soup and salad. So if you have a better combination of actors.
You do. Let us know.
Yeah. Send it to us at texaspodcastmassacre@gmail.com, txpodmassacre on Twitter, and then texaspodcastmassacre on everything else.
Yeah.
All right, Nate, we got a lot to unpack.
Hold on. And iTunes reviews.
Apple Podcast reviews.
Yeah, iTunes app podcasts. I mean, Team Basement firmly in the lead, but I would like to see the lead go up. We really got to rub it in the addicts' faces. And it's so hard to get up there to rub it in their face. You got to climb a ladder. It's a total pain.
People who are saying Team Basement, you understand that you're saying that basements are
better
than addicts, not that they're scarier. Because I think some people are confused and they think they're picking Team Basement like, oh, no, I don't want to be in a basement.
No, you're Team Basement. Just like in this film, you're either Team Edward or Team Jacob. It's obvious. No. Okay.
And that's not an indictment on some of our listeners. I think that's more that they probably don't understand what the hell we're talking about. That's more an indictment on us.
If you like basements better than attics, just let us know.
If you think your chances of survival are better in a basement than an attic, one, you're crazy. But two, that's what you're effectively. This is really the election that matters this year.
Sure.
I said this year.
Sure. Okay. It's the same. I'm responding exactly the same.
Yeah.
The basement caucuses are open.
Oh my God.
You guys and vote. Get out the vote. Puff Daddy style.
But we appreciate all of your reviews. Maybe not so much you, Mr. One Star out there, but the rest. I'm just kidding.
You have
but
so many grudges today.
I do. Well, it's because the new Grudge trailer came out.
Oh my God. Let's roll the clip.
Oh, man. Anyway, thank you very much for your reviews. As always, if you leave us a review and a movie you'd like us to watch, it moves up the priority list. We have our schedules set out through like January or February.
Yeah, but we can always,
you cut the line with a good review.
Exactly.
So, with that said, Nate, let's get into this week's movie of the week, The Lighthouse.
Tell me, what's a timberman want with being a wickie?
Just looking to earn a living, just like any man. Starting new.
On the run. Keeping secrets, are you?
No, sir.
Watch you spill your beans. Watch you spill your beans. Watch you spill your beans.
5 weeks? 2 days? Help me to recollect.
Nate, I can't begin to explain the movie I just saw.
Well, you have to explain it without spoilers first.
Yes.
So that'll make it even easier.
That's right. Yeah. So so this is, yeah, that's right. We are doing a, like we do with all new movies, there is a spoiler-free section of the podcast, and then, you know, we go right into spoilers. So you can still... You can still listen a little bit, but if you don't want anything ruined for you, definitely go see the movie, first off.
Yeah, it's I mean, it's a limited release.
Now, I'll say this. Lisa doesn't need to be here for me to say this. Unsuspecting victims would hate this movie. Is that fair? I mean, it is not. This is not a movie for everyone.
It's not a crowd pleaser.
No.
It is a film shot on...
It is an art film.
It's an art film shot on a lens that's over 100 years old. In a boxy, super boxy, at old school aspect ratio, in black and white, that features essentially two characters in the 1890s Northeast in a lighthouse.
Yeah.
So
I'll
basically Black Panther 2.
Yeah,
essentially.
I'll give you the elevator pitch. Two guys have to keep a lighthouse going. They do not equitably share the chores, and
seniority.
They may or may not go crazy.
There you go. Sounds like every job, really.
Well, yeah, fair.
You're the lighthouse.
Now, Nate, the cool thing with this episode is, you know, you get your facts from the internet, so you know we don't ever verify them. So who knows? They probably are all half wrong.
Wait, what?
What?
Okay.
No. But for this one, you were lucky enough to actually hear Robert Eggers talk about it at Q&A.
Fantastic Fest.
So, yeah. Yes. What can you tell us about The Lighthouse?
Well, I don't want to tell you any of that until after we get to the spoiler section. So the Q&A, no. But this film came out.
Glad we coordinated on that before.
Yeah, I mean, we really coordinated on this. Thank you for that. This came out October 18th. It didn't come out October 18th in our area. It came out like a week later.
Yeah,
in the theaters here.
Yep.
But yeah, this is a 1 hour 49 minute odyssey into the psyche and egos and absolute calamity that befalls two people. Robert Eggers is only other movie is The Witch. But he's got a lot of things bubbling a little bit. He's supposed to be doing a Nosferatu film. He is tied to that.
Okay.
And that's supposed to have Anya Taylor-Joy from The Witch in it. He's got a film called The Northman in pre-production, which is a Viking revenge saga in Iceland.
Okay.
So that sounds awesome.
Yeah.
And I am in. Oh, do you know who's rumored to be in that film? That little guy named Bill Skarsgård.
Well, there you go.
Oh, yeah. You're in. You're already in.
Full in. Yep.
Yep. And then I think Nicole Kidman didn't realize that The Lighthouse and Aquaman were two movies. Maybe she thought she was doing the sequel because Nicole Kidman is in this Viking movie as well. And rumored, obviously, Anya Taylor-Joy is rumored for everything he's going to be in. And Willem Dafoe might be coming back as well.
Oh, wow.
Okay. Yeah. So get ready for some fucking batshit crazy Vikings at the turn of the 10th century. This guy's like, I can't do any movie that takes place in the last 100 and some years. I just can't. It is literally impossible. So one of the main actors in this film, there are essentially two and a mermaid, is Willem Dafoe. Willem Dafoe of Speed 2 Cruise Control fame.
Yes.
When she went over
that's what everyone remembers him from.
Speed 2 Cruise Control. He's in a shit ton of films. I mean, he was in John Wick.
Yeah.
That was Keanu Reeves. Again, we were just going to go back to the Constantine episode. He was in Aquaman. He's also Aquaman. He's like, oh, Aquaman, Ride to the Lighthouse. Maybe it's the same set. You know,
there's a lighthouse in Aquaman, I believe.
That's what I'm saying. He's essentially there.
Is it the same actual lighthouse?
No, it's not.
Okay. I was just trying to replay in my head. Like,
that would be awesome, but it is not.
Okay.
He was on Murder on the Orient Express. He has been in just so many things. He is a really great, if you want to watch a movie that'll tug at your heartstrings, he is a ridiculously mean writer in The Fault in Our Stars. Classic. Mm-hmm. Grand Budapest Hotel, A Most Wanted Man, Nymphomaniac, only the second
Nymphomac.
One. Nymphomac, which is called Nymphomac. That sounds nice. I remember him being in the Beyond Two Souls video game.
Mm-hmm.
He's done some video game work. He's in every film. Antichrist, that's a good one. Obviously Spider-Man.
Yeah.
He's the Green Goblin.
Yeah, which the Green Goblin's mask is basically his face just painted green.
Dang it. Life Aquatic is real good. Finding Nemo and Finding Nemo the video game.
Oh, well, you got
well, hey, that. They didn't get Keanu Reeves for the Constantine video game. So there's that. I like how in one year he was in The English Patient, and the next year he was in Speed 2 Cruise Control. Look, this guy is awesome.
His agent is not letting him turn down any roles. Like,
exactly. Yeah, he's done a bunch of stuff.
I forgot he's the voice of Reek in Death Note, which is a garbage movie, but he was
fine.
Yes,
yes, yes. He was fine. Yeah. He was fine. I mean, he just played Vincent Van Gogh. Last year as well.
Mm-hmm.
He's everywhere. He's great. Very distinctive face. And this movie uses that amazingly well.
Yeah.
On the other side, we got teen. He's not even a teen anymore. He's like the same age as us. Teen heartthrob Robert Pattinson. You might remember him from all the Twilights.
He doesn't want you to remember that.
He got the money from Twilight and he's like, okay, now I'm going to do things I like.
Yeah,
and that's what he does now.
Yeah,
it was awesome.
He doesn't ever want to talk about it either. I've never seen someone just like refuse to acknowledge anything.
like a lot of people are like, oh, I'll go back to Comic-Con after like the 10-year anniversary of, you know, this show I was on for a little bit, or like, oh, this cult movie. He will never reunite with anyone ever for anything Twilight related, unless he ends up going Nick Cage style and like buying a bunch of castles and he needs a bunch of money. Maybe then. And then it's like one off. It's like Jamie Lee Curtis in Halloween Resurrection. 10 lines, 15 minutes, and that's it. He's going to be Batman. So
that's right.
He's going to be Batman. So
now, you're not a huge superhero.
Real Hollywood movie.
Yeah, you're not a big superhero movie guy.
No, I'm not.
So
unless it's Blade or Constantine.
You're right. But when you heard the Batman news, what did you think?
I am a fan of this dude, so... Yeah, that makes me more likely to
I feel
go see
a
this.
Lot better about it after seeing this movie.
Oh, his acting is so great.
Yeah.
His acting is very good.
Yeah, and
if you saw him, so he did the Twilights, and then he's like, okay. And he was Cedric Diggory.
Yes.
At least it's not here.
T's and P's.
Yeah, like Goblet of Fire, and then he got it massively murdered, and it was awesome.
T's and P's.
He played Salvador Dali in Little Ashes. That movie was okay. But you could see him starting to be like an actor in that one. They did Twilight's. Oof, down. Then Cosmopolis is a good film with him.
Okay.
I don't know if you've seen Cosmopolis or not. The Rover with Guy Pearce.
Okay.
Australia. I watched way too many movies. This is ridiculous. Life.
That's right. He was in Life.
Yeah.
Life. Life is good.
He was in Lost City of Z with Charlie Hunnam, the guy from Pacific Rim.
Mm-hmm.
He's great there. Go on Amazon Prime right now. Watch Good Time. If you want to see Robert Pattinson with extremely terribly dyed blonde hair as a New Yorker who robs a bank with his mentally challenged cousin. It is awesome. He was in High Life, the French film.
Okay.
You can watch that now. It's streaming. It's on Amazon Prime also. That was okay. And The King just came out like this week. On Netflix.
Mm-hmm.
Timothée Chalamet plays King Henry of England.
Yeah.
And Robert Pattinson plays the Dauphin of France. He has the most ridiculous wig and ridiculous French accent in the history of Earth. steals the entire movie. Amazing.
Yeah, I haven't watched it yet.
Just watch it for Robert Pattinson's part. His parts are maybe minutes of the film. Best part of the movie, he's amazing. That movie made me even more excited for Batman. I don't know how that's even possible, but him in a bad wig doing slapstick comedy in a suit of armor with the most insane. He's like kind of like he almost is like, imagine if Rucker Hauer in Hitcher was a medieval king of France. Yeah, imagine that.
Which Henry is he? Is he supposed to be Henry V or?
Yes, I believe so.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. I'm trying to remember all the different.
So like, Henrys. Oh, Timothy Chalamet, I like him a lot. Yeah, he's great. And then he gets immediately upstaged by Robert Pattinson in this role. So, but he's still good. But anyway, yeah, watch that. It looks amazing. And he's got a couple of movies coming in, but just watch all the shit. Oh yeah, and he's gonna be starring in the next Christopher Nolan movie.
Which one's that?
It's called Tenet. It's a espionage, action espionage time travel movie.
Oh, okay.
So you know you love the time travel. We are huge proponents of time travel. Never.
No.
Unless it's Terminator.
Terminator only.
And then only when they don't go into the backstory. Like you go one direction, you're done. You never see anything else.
Yeah.
And then you don't retcon it in like Terminator 3 through 4 through 5 through 6.
Yeah.
Yeah. So then that's mainly it. In terms of the trivia of this film, it was based on a real life story from the early 1800s for two Welsh lightkeepers. Also, I want to say thanks to the Welsh people downloading our podcast. The north of England and Welsh.
Bonjour.
Us. I am an insane person for learning language stuff. Did you know, Mitch, that in Welsh...
We know the answer is no.
Did you know, Mitch, that the term for skipping school in Wales is called mitching?
Sounds right.
Did you know this?
I did not know that.
I just assumed it meant like when you're a kid, it's like, oh, you're skipping school. But when you're an adult, it's like, you know, skipping all of your responsibilities and being just generally untrustworthy.
That all of that is mitching?
All of that is mitching, yes. I just expanded the definition.
Guess my ass, Wales. I don't know what to tell you.
Wow. No, we love Wales. Like, you can say anything you want about Idaho, but how dare you be smirch Wales? But thanks for the Welsh people. Their language is literally allergic to vowels. And I don't know.
Yeah.
I was trying reading it. I'm like, I need a little guide here. I need a little guide.
I mean, yeah, if anything was a line on a Wheel of Fortune, you couldn't buy a vowel.
Exactly.
It would do you nothing.
A lot of Y. There's Ys. But yeah. So Willem Dafoe, his method of acting is to practice things over and over again. Robert Pattinson's method of acting is to just roll with it during the take, right? Mm-hmm. Those are clashing styles.
Yes.
So that is apparent in the movie. There's tension literally just because of the way they act.
Yeah.
Which I think really added to the film.
Because I agree.
The tension in this film between these two people vacillates wildly scene to scene and is just menacing to funny to fart jokes.
A lot of fart jokes.
It's not really jokes, just farting generally. Yeah. But to jokes, to drinking, to menace.
The first like fucking thing you see in this movie is Willem Dafoe farting, like right.
Yep.
Yeah.
So because of that, they did not talk to each other on set very much because the filming was very physically demanding.
Yeah.
It's like an Ari Aster movie. Like, you know what you're getting. Like, okay, Toni Collette, you're going to have to scream for 87 hours. So just, you're not going to want to hang out with anybody.
I bet she had a wonderful time doing Knives Out.
Oh, yeah. Exactly.
She seems a lot more relaxed.
Yeah,
she's
very relaxed. Exactly. Like in Midsommar or like in the movie Mother where Jennifer Lawrence said like she broke a rib because she was screaming like so much.
Yeah.
In that film. I mean, you know, those are films that are trying. This is one of those films. Knives Out looks like a lot of fun.
Yeah.
another movie that we missed at Fantastic Fest earlier. So the film, but this film is set in 1890. It is shot on 35 millimeter black and white film. The lenses are literally about 100 years old.
Mm-hmm.
And the aspect ratio is 1.19:1. Normally, you're not hearing me talk about aspect ratios in these movies very often. Not talking about, the 13 ghosts aspect ratio. But this is essentially a square. It's almost a square. It's a little bit wider on the horizontal.
Yeah.
And it's essentially just a box.
You stop noticing it after the first few minutes.
You do. But in the beginning, it's like, oh, there's a lot of black on the sides of the screen there.
Yeah.
The birds in this film, all real birds.
There's one scene. It does not look real.
All real, baby. Well, except one scene. There's one obvious scene where it's not real. All the other scenes, the birds are real, man.
Okay. Then I clearly was able to pick out the one scene where they were.
We'll get into it later, but I'm going to leave a little tease. As part of this movie, Robert Eggers did research on shark labias. That's what I'm going to go out on.
What a hell of a thing to go to leave everyone with. All right. Well, so let's overall thoughts, Nate. What did you think about this movie when you first saw it?
I saw it, it was a secret screening, so didn't know what the movie was going to be. You saw the other secret screening before, which is Dolomite Is My Name, which is on Netflix.
Which I highly recommend. Not horror film, won't talk about here, but highly recommend. It's a great movie.
Exactly. And Dolomite is on Amazon Prime. Too.
Oh, nice.
So you can watch the OG film that film is about on two streaming services. Fantastic. Nice. So then it was secret screening. The guy's like, oh, give me what do you think it is? And everyone's listing out the most ridiculous indie films that no one's ever heard of ever, because that's the crowd. And I was like, it better be the fucking Lighthouse. And he's like, well, we'll bring out the director to introduce the movie, and you'll know what movie it is. And it was Robert Eggers. I'm like, are you fucking kidding me? This guy is the best. Huge man crush.
Oh yeah, you were so Eggers. it was so cute. You were so embarrassed to go say anything to him afterwards.
I was.
You were just standing there talking to him. You're like, oh, I want to say something. I don't want to be weird.
Dude, Robert Eggers is
amazing. I'm glad you got to see it, because you love The Witch.
I love The Witch. I think I gave it a 9 out of 10. In the show, and I'm an idiot. It's a 10 out of 10. Yeah. I don't even know what I'm talking
about. Yeah. So your overall thoughts.
So watch the film and there with the crowd, and the movie has laughter in it. It is starkly filmed. I mean, I've never seen shadows. I've never seen shadows in the film. I don't even know how to describe it. Like the way light plays on people's faces and different things. There's a foghorn that is just one of the most ominous sounds you've ever heard in your life. After a while, you're just like,
it just randomly comes on and off.
Yeah,
too.
Just foghorn. Like, are you kidding me? You're put in the place of these people, and you get the descent is real. Like, you are part of the descent. Seagulls are dicks. That we established that early in the film.
Yes.
But really, it's Willem Dafoe, Robert Pattinson just acting the shit out of this movie.
Yeah.
And they both crush it. And they crush it in different ways. That's obvious. And it's real good. There's a supernatural component to it that comes in later. And it's just, it's like you're dropped down in a particular time period and you just see shit go off the rails. It's exactly what The Witch was. You get dropped into the 1600s, Puritan time area. And then you see something's a little bit supernatural and you're just like, this is going off the rails. And I'm there for it. And that's what this film is.
Yeah.
It's really hard to describe.
Is no real way to describe this movie, and there's really no way to prepare someone to go see this movie adequately.
Just go see it.
You should go. Now, I definitely think you should definitely see it. I will say for Lisa had absolutely no desire to see this movie.
This is such a not Lisa movie.
No.
Ooh, man. No, not a Lisa film.
The entire time through the movie, I'm just like, oh, Lisa would hate this. Lisa would hate this. Lisa would hate this. So for your unsuspecting victims in your life, this may be a hard sell.
This is a hard sell.
It's not, and I mean, it's not that it's overly scary, but it is really fucking weird.
It's very weird.
Yeah.
It gets disturbing. You do not know what's going to happen.
Yeah.
This is so not predictable.
This movie is really, it's less for horror fans and more just for film nerds.
Yeah. And I did skip over. I mean, this film was done for $4 million. So far it's made about $7.5 million.
There you go.
So it's a small independent film. When the Blu-ray comes out, I will be pre-ordering the Blu-ray. That's obvious.
Yeah.
This is a Blu-ray collection worthy film for me. Yeah. If Constantine, Ice Cream Man, and previous other films didn't get you to be in my Blu-ray collection.
Well, I've told you before, I
I don't typically rewatch a lot of movies.
This is a rewatcher.
I walked out of the movie wanting to watch this again.
If you're even interested at all in this film at the end, you got to see it a second time.
Yeah.
I don't even know if that's up for debate.
The things that I feel like you'll catch the second time through.
Yes, exactly.
No, but I enjoyed it. It is, but I don't think I can say it any other way. It is really fucking weird, and nothing you read online, anyone tells you is going to prepare you.
Just go watch it. And this is, again, an A24 joint.
Yeah.
You know it's going to be good. Most of the time, yeah. With A24, and yeah, I mean, nails it.
Yeah, so let's give a little background on kind of these characters in the setting.
Sure. I mean,
so there's
two characters.
They're basically starting.
They're both named Thomas. That wasn't the whale story. They're both have the same name too.
No,
this is you can't make this shit up. Sorry, he starts as Ephraim.
Yeah.
So Robert Pattinson is Ephraim. He's the younger. Wiki, which is a lighthouse keeper.
Mm-hmm.
You're going to get a lot of 1890s Northeast America slang.
And it looks like this is the first time they've ever worked together.
Yes, definitely.
So, you know, it's telling to see, you know, you see them coming up the cliff to the little cottage, and Willem Dafoe's character has like barely anything that he's bringing up with him. And
Robert Pattinson
is like carrying like 80... You know,
yep.
He's presumably carrying both of their stuff, not just his.
Yes,
but yeah, it's,
he is the he's the bitch.
Yeah,
it's really no other way to say.
I didn't sign up to be nobody's wife.
Yeah, but yeah, no, yeah. So Willem Dafoe is just kind of like, yeah, I get to be in the lighthouse at night, and you have to do all the shit work, literally and figuratively. Ooh man, the shit in this, and it's in black and white, so you can't really get. I mean. You're smelling it in this film. Like you can't, the shit is real. The shit gets real. They drink shit. There's a whole vat of shit. There's falling in shit. Ooh, man.
Yeah.
It's like that hot pie Game of Thrones, but like extended.
Yes.
But not, that's a good, not as gross necessarily, but like.
Well, yeah, it's not in color, so that helps.
Exactly. But yeah, you get the intricacies of what Robert Pattinson essentially is forced to do. Willem Dafoe gets the glamour job, just being up in the lighthouse.
Well, the minute that the first thing you see is Robert Pattinson going up into the bedroom, and you don't see Willem Dafoe, but you hear him, and he's pissing, and then he's farting all over the place, and then you just see him like kick over this pot, and you're like, oh Christ, there's chamber pots. Okay.
Oh yeah.
Oh,
by the bed. Mmm, lovely. Lovely. I mean,
you don't want to have to go too far, Nate. When the mood hits you, you want to be able to just
take care of it. Get a fucking outhouse.
There's no room on this little island.
It's a
lighthouse.
Rock. It is not hospitable.
Welcome to the rock.
It's bad. It's real bad.
Yeah.
I'd rather be an Alcatraz in this place. That's for sure.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, Willem Dafoe is also kind of a dick, and by kind of, I mean massively.
Yes.
He's like, oh, you're not gonna drink with me? Well, they're like, fuck you, I'm gonna mess with you until you drink with me.
Yeah. He's that guy.
There's some sea cursing he does. I don't think he blinks. There are scenes in this film where I'm like, I don't think Willem Dafoe has blinked for a long time.
God, you're right. I didn't even pay attention.
His eyes are always open and they are huge, like the entire like second half of the film. Like, I don't know. I think he's like chugging Visine with his eyes. Like he was not blinking. I don't know what was going on with him.
Yeah.
Whew, man. But no, yeah, anyway, so you basically essentially see as time goes on, they become better friends, and then they don't.
And then they kind of go back and forth a lot.
They go back and forth. That is true. The beginning, he hates him. Then he starts warming up to him. Then as soon as anything bad happens, then they're at each other's throats.
Yeah, exactly.
But yeah, the dynamic between the two is essentially the whole film. And Robert Eggers throws in different, you know, kind of smaller things at first that kind of drive the wedge between, and then larger and larger things. Sea curses, sea superstitions. There's definitely some hallucinations.
Mm-hmm.
And by definitely, I mean, yes, massively.
Yeah.
Birds are dicks. That's odd. That we've already went over this in the birds episode.
Yeah.
Birds are dicks. That's easy.
What I think was interesting is very similar to The Witch. Most of this movie is really spent trying to figure out what's real and what isn't.
Yes.
You know, and without getting into many spoilery details around that, but there's a lot of parts where you're like, okay, is this actually happening? Is Robert Pattinson sort of seeing this? Is Willem Dafoe sort of just saying, you know, what's really that's going on over here? How much of what we're seeing is real? Because in The Witch, you have a lot of those scenes where you're like, okay, is this actually happening? Is this, you know, it's not until the end that you're like, oh shit, you know, and you get your answer.
Yeah.
And this one I think is a little less satisfying in that regard by the time you get to the end.
Yeah.
Yeah. Anything else you want to say about this before we spoil the shit out of it?
This is a really hard one to talk about without giving it away.
Yeah.
So we apologize for this shorter spoiler-free section.
Yeah.
But I would just say if you kind of like any, if you like a other A24 films that are maybe a little bit more on the art side, definitely go see this.
Yes.
I'm not taking my mom to this. Okay. Like, I'm not, oh, hey mom, you're here for Thanksgiving. No,
didn't you make your mom watch Troll 2 in The Room?
Oh, my mom's watched Troll 2, The Room, Miami Connection. She's a veteran.
Oh.
Actually, I watched Crawl with my mom.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, she liked it. She used to live in Miami. She's like, oh yeah, Florida, got it.
Yeah, Florida the movie.
Florida got it. Yep.
Yeah.
Mitch, would you recommend people seeing this?
I do. Again, I think it is. It's going to have a very specific audience. You know, if you like sort of if you like movies that are like Requiem for a Dream and, you know, Black Swan and all these sort of mind trippy, what the hell's happening, really fucking weird type of movies. If you're into that stuff, you don't have to necessarily be a film nerd, but if you like those kind of things, you'll love this movie. If those movies, you hate them,
you're not going to like
them. You're going to hate this movie.
If you like The Witch, that helps too, obviously. Same director.
The Witch is just a little different. The Witch at least
is different,
a little
bit, but you have the same, similar vibe.
Yeah.
For sure.
Yeah, exactly.
Yep.
Yeah, so I would say go see it in theaters. But yeah, understand it's certainly not for everyone. So if any of those movies that I listed don't sit well with you.
Yeah, you might be.
You might just want to wait.
I want to throw this out with a chamber pot, if you will.
All right, well, that said, look, if you are going to go see it and you don't want to spoil it, you need to get out of here.
Get out of here, witch!
All right, let's spoil this. Let's spoil this thing.
Yeah, let's spoil it.
Let's get into it. Where do we even start? There's so much shit to...
More masturbating in this film than I thought there would be.
Yeah.
We're just going to go right from the jump here.
A lot of masturbation.
Both people masturbate. I think some of Willem Dafoe's ejaculate spills onto Robert Pattinson.
God, that scene was gross.
I mean, look.
Also, if that is his ejaculate, he needs to go see a doctor.
It was like,
well, because he imagines. I mean, it's right before he imagines him with tentacles and everything.
Yes.
So I guess it's supposed to be more that it's slime.
Saying it's tentacle porn. Gross.
I did not say that.
That's what
but
you essentially just said.
No, I did. Oh God. All right.
Anyway, so let's go over the central premise.
Okay.
Central premise from Ephraim/Thomas's side. So mm-hmm. He gives him a fake name in the beginning. So that's shady. He killed somebody.
Well, he just didn't stop an accident.
He killed somebody in a logging-related incident who was his boss because he doesn't like bosses.
Yeah.
And he seems to be an okay worker with a massive chip on his shoulder. Not a reliable narrator at all, like we were going over.
Yeah, he doesn't want to be told what to do.
And that's kind of the whole point of a hierarchy in a job. So he let that guy get crushed to death by huge logs. So that sucks.
Yeah.
For that guy. Anyway, he's on the run from that, and he took that guy's name, and that's why he had the fake name, and yeah, now he's a wiki. Now he's a lighthouse keeper. So he's just, you know, whatever, and he's just going from job to job trying to figure out something that'll give him enough money. He thinks he's going to get money here. Willem Dafoe fucks with his money, and that's one of the main plot points toward the end, and he's like, I don't like that. Don't mess with me, and yeah, go from there. Man, I wanted to talk about they drink kerosene at the end of the film.
Yeah, because they ran out of alcohol.
Oh, boy.
Yeah, that's not going to help.
Oh, boy. That is...
Nate, have you ever been so desperate for booze that you drink kerosene?
No, that is just, I can't eat. It was so, I was taken aback when that happened. I'm like, no. You know Parks and Rec.
Yeah.
You know, when they do the drink off for Ron, but Tammy won
his mom and Leslie.
Yeah. And it's like the only thing.
I thought you were going to talk about snake juice.
No, I drink snake juice. Hold on. I'm in on snake juice. No, but yeah, the it's like this is the only thing it's supposed to be used for is like tear varnish off things. This was worse than that.
Yeah.
That's how bad this was. So yeah, I did not care for that. When they're drinking, everyone's happy. Everyone's drinking. They're happy. They're singing songs. They're dancing.
Yep.
They're like groping on each other. It's kind of weird. There's definitely a sexual tension in this film.
Yeah.
At least for a little bit.
Yeah.
Because you're all, you know, what do you think about the wood woman figurine? No porn. No Playboys.
Porn was porn back in the day, I guess. You know, it's...
His porn? A, like, 2-inch tall wooden figurine of a woman.
Yeah.
That's his porn.
Now, he several times sees this mermaid. And at one point is banging it.
That's where the shark labias come in. So, they designed the vagina of the mermaid based on shark's vagina. So there you go. Extra fin. That's 2 extra fins. Anyway, so that's a thing. Yeah, where he imagines having sex with a mermaid.
Yeah.
So that was something. And they show it a decent amount.
Yeah, yeah. It's
and they're not, this isn't the cutaway movie. This movie Robert is the lean in movie.
Masturbated no less than 3 times.
Yeah. You got Willem Dafoe at least once.
Yeah. Willem Dafoe's just naked in the lighthouse tower for some reason.
He's looking at the light. It's like transfixing him. And Robert Pattinson's like, well, I'm jealous of that, obviously. And he should, if he gave him turns, it'd have been fine.
Yep.
But Willem Dafoe's a total dick. So no one really looks good here in this film.
Yeah.
There's a lot of gray area. Pun intended with the black and white film that we have here. Yeah.
Now this is an art film, so I think we'd be remiss to not talk about some of the themes and some of the symbolism in this movie. One thing that I kind of caught on that I don't think after because I kind of looked online after the movie to just, you know, score, like, I didn't see a lot. It seems like there's a little bit of a theme around almost kind of mirroring the whole millennial baby boomer sort of thing, like this sort of generational.
Well, there's that.
Right. Yeah, because, there's a lot of this tension is around, you know, he thinks he should, you know, Robert Pattinson's like, I went to school. I read up the manual. I've learned all the things I have to do to be a wiki. Let me in the lighthouse. And, you know, Willem Dafoe as the boomer is.
I think
there's less of it. It was just
there's a generational aspect.
Yeah.
Oh yeah, definitely. Yeah, yeah. Willem Dafoe's
because there's a few like comments there where I was like, I don't think that's largely what Robert Eggers is trying to talk about. There. But I think there's that.
It's definitely not about banging mermaids.
No,
it does happen.
That is a means to an end.
It's really a thing about power dynamics.
Yeah.
In the job. I think, right? It's just power dynamics between two people. Which is what essentially every story is, a lot of them.
Yeah.
But in this job, power dynamics in isolation, I think, is really what it is about.
Yeah.
And Willem Dafoe wields it, and at the end, he's not wielding it as much anymore.
No.
He tries to make Robert Pattinson think he's crazy, and at first you're like, oh, yeah, he is crazy. And then you're like, I don't know about that.
Right.
So it definitely plays with, like, who is reliable. And I think the answer is neither. Neither of them are reliable. He takes an axe to something. He's like, hey, you axed that. No, we just saw you axe a boat that potentially could be leaving the area.
Yeah.
You didn't do that. Like that was pretty cut and dry.
Some of it seemed like, you can make the case that maybe it was a little bit in Robert Pattinson's head, but then you see things where Willem Dafoe is clearly trying to push him toward being crazy and sort
of. Yes, he is. Yeah.
You know, so because it ties in with his log of, he should be, he's going to get severance without pay.
Dock his wages, all that kind of shit.
Yeah.
Yeah. Which then he sees
when he's made Robert Pattinson do all the grunt work.
Exactly. And you learn that he killed his old lighthouse mate.
Did he or
I
was
believe
that,
he did.
See, I didn't
That's it's ambiguous. I'm taking a guess here. Yeah. I think he killed him.
It's possible.
He's goading him into all this shit. He almost drops him. You know, there's a lot of little small things that happen. I mean, he drops him and he injures his leg/back.
Yeah.
From painting the lighthouse. He just like dropped. I mean, it wasn't like he was flying about. He just dropped him.
Yeah.
Not a fan. Doesn't like sharing the lighthouse. Mm-hmm. He like is naked looking at the light. Like the light is transfixing him. He doesn't want to share it with anybody. So if someone was like, oh yeah, I actually have seniority or whatever. Yeah, he would kill that person instantaneously.
Now the ultimate end of this conflict when they have the fight and then Robert Pattinson makes him bark like a dog.
Yeah, that was Deliverance-esque.
And then, like, walks him out on a leash to bury him alive. I'm like,
in the ration pit.
Jesus
Christ.
Well,
okay, so as time goes on, we're skipping huge plot points here.
Sure. Well, we're presuming that if you're at this point,
they are supposed to be getting relieved.
Yeah.
And they do not get relieved for a while. Then Willem Dafoe tells the story, like, oh, yeah, there was, like, months where they were, like, so the rations are starting to run out. The storms are getting more. Now, why did the storms get more? Could this be the weather patterns, or it could be Robert Pattinson does the seagull die.com. Yes.
That
he
is
smashes.
Holy. I mean, I
bam
think
bam
I,
from the Flintstones.
I think just, like, in the theater out loud went, holy shit.
Yeah.
I mean, it is intense.
Destroys, grabs the legs and just destroys the seagull. I mean, the Patriot style. I mean, he's hitting it so many more times than was necessary. It was dead. Because the seagull kept taunting him. Knocks on the window, all that shit. Amazing. Robert Eggers said working with the birds was a million times better than working with the goat from The Witch.
Oh,
I know. Poor goat.
Poor Black Phillip.
He's like, the only reason the goat looked cool is because my editor is amazing. So I was like, oh, shit. Black Phillip, man. Getting some real shade.
Yeah, get bodied, Black Phillip.
He did not act deliciously in that film. But yeah, no, the birds are apparently amazing. Apparently there's one dude in England, he's got a couple. There's like three different birds, I think.
Yeah,
birds crushed it. There you go.
Nice.
Yeah, the birds are great. They're dicks in the movie, but apparently in real life they're great. So the fight, yeah. So
now the bird only had one eye, as far as we could tell, right?
What?
Okay. Well, I'll come back to it.
I saw it a little bit later, or a little while ago, so I'm not sure.
Okay.
On that specific detail.
Okay. We'll get to it when we get to the end. I'll circle back to my thought around it.
Okay, sure. Anyway, so the climax is just, you know, hey, look, the storm is just huge. It broke everything. There's a ration pit. We got rations. And then Robert Pattinson's like, sweet. And Willem Dafoe digs it up. It's all alcohol.
Yeah.
Those are they're just getting hammered. I mean, they're just like on a bender. No food. Everything's going to shit, literally and figuratively. Yeah. I mean, nothing's getting cleaned. Like, they're just out of their minds.
Yeah.
And they're just happy and sad and slapping each other and just dancing and singing and leveling some of the most, I mean, Willem Dafoe's threats in this film are some of the most titanic threats.
Oh yeah.
That have ever been uttered by any person.
Doesn't he
in
invoke
a film.
Poseidon to come and
he invokes
smite
Poseidon
him? Because Robert Pattinson said he didn't like his cooking.
I mean, there is just some that's another non-blinking scene, too.
Yeah.
When he's cursing at him, there's just no blinks coming from this dude. It's crazy. And then, you know, you see the movie more from Robert Pattinson's side.
Yeah.
And, you know, he's just like, he keeps doing all these little shit to push me. And then eventually he snaps. So the fight scene, this is not Jet Li.
No.
It's a real down and dirty fight scene.
Yeah.
Not very effective. They're hammered.
Right.
Or they're hungover. Either way, not very agile. What did you think about the fight scene?
I mean, it was good.
It was the climax of the film.
It was what you'd expect. I don't want to see a Jet Li, Jackie Chan fight scene.
But imagine Willem Dafoe as a Bruce Lee type doing the Chris Pratt Instagram workout videos, getting a real buff for this. He worked on his fart game. He definitely
worked his fart game.
He worked on his fart game. He worked on his curse game. And then he's working on his martial arts game. Imagine him just like tear away pants, just come off. And then he's just throwing out star blocks. He's throwing He's throwing out high kicks, God. Double kicks, scorpion kicks, shadow kicks, all the kicks. Willem Dafoe. There's a lot of shadows in this movie. I guess all kicks are shadow kicks.
Nate, what I meant to ask you, speaking of Willem Dafoe, was there a tagline for this movie?
Yes, there was. They're always the tagline. And this is just an off-the-cuff episode. So
yeah.
I'm more of the Robert Pattinson type, not the Willem Dafoe type in this one. But the tagline is, there is enchantment in the light. It's essentially the end of the film, or the whole film from Willem Dafoe's perspective.
Okay.
He loves the light. There's something magic in the light. Like he.
Do you like that?
Yeah, it's fine. There's enchantment in the light.
Okay.
You can't say there's an enchantment in banging a mermaid. I can't say that.
I would have just called it Willem Dafoe or Willem Dafriend. You decide.
Willem Dafriend or Willem Dafoe?
Yeah.
Like,
who's to say?
This whole film is Twilight. Featuring Robert Pattinson. They probably do better in the box office. No, I mean, so this fight, this is the climax. So Mitch, take us through it. So we're not going Bruce Lee.
No, I mean,
this is a hard scrabble fight.
Yeah, they're falling over each other because they're drunk.
Kerosene drunk.
Yeah.
Not just drunk. Oh, I've had a few too many beers. I got kerosene in me and I was not, and I was liberal with the amount of kerosene I was drinking.
Like
I wasn't holding
it's like
back.
A Metallica song. Like, give me fuel, give me fire, give me that much I desire.
But the fire could be inside you because you literally, again, drank kerosene.
They tussle around for a bit. I think someone gets kicked in the nuts at one point. And then Robert Pattinson just starts punching him in the face. But as he's punching him, he sees the guy he killed from
the log jam.
Jesus. Which is interesting because, at the beginning of the movie, he sees when he's walking out into the water, he sees all those logs coming in.
Exactly. Yeah.
And then he sees the mermaid that he was banging.
He bangs once. Yeah.
Kind of awkward.
Not real also.
Yeah. And then Willem Dafoe is a squid.
Yes. Tentacle.
As Davy Jones, I guess. I don't know.
It's just tentacle. Sure. Tentacle man.
Sure. Tentacle man.
But anyway, yeah. So he's punching him in the face.
Yeah.
Then what?
Then he makes him bark like a dog afterwards.
Exactly. What is that? So he's like, I beat you.
Yeah.
I punch you in the face. He's like, stop. Reads his logs. Oh, gets even more pissed.
But no, he's already read the logs.
I know. It's the same. But like, that is adding to the fire. That's adding to your Metallica fire right there.
But now that he is in control, you know, you talk about the power dynamic.
Exactly.
He's like, no, you're the dog. You bark. I'm like, this got real weird real quick.
I would have thrown him in the shit. I would have thrown him in the shit cistern.
Oh, Jesus.
I would have thrown him in there.
Could have died from tuberculosis or something.
Oh, probably.
Then he makes him walk out on a leash, which where he found the leash, couldn't tell you.
Everything is shattered. They have no food. They're drinking kerosene, but leash technology readily available.
He's able to fashion a noose real quick to make him walk and then throws him in the ration pit. Just starts burying him alive. And that scene is crazy too, because Willem Dafoe is still talking. He's getting dirt literally just thrown in his face. God damn. Yeah.
But you don't antagonize the person who has more physical strength than you, which is why you should be doing workout videos, but I digress. Yep. He's not dead.
No, he's not, because he shows back up with the axe in like 5 minutes later.
Yeah, then he's not dead. And there's loose packing. When you're going to bury someone, you got to pack down, okay? If you don't pack, they're going to come up. Zombies, everything.
He didn't finish the job. He just left them half-assed
exactly,
out there.
Exactly. Yeah. So he uses the axe to take the only boat gone.
Yep.
And then he blames him for it. He's like gaslighting him massively. I don't even know what's happening.
Yeah.
Then shit gets real. So what did you think of the end of the fight?
Of the end of the fight, man, I mean, look, if you're going to attack a former logger with an axe, you better not fucking miss.
Yeah, he's the axe man.
That man knows how to use it. Yeah,
exactly.
And he did. Man, that crunk, you know, noise. Yeah, it's like
thwunk.
Oh, yeah. I don't know. Yeah, it just, oh.
He got thwunked hard.
Oh, and yeah, it was brutal.
So still drunk on kerosene, just murdered Willem Dafoe. I was like, what am I going to do? I'm going to finally get in the top of that lighthouse. Yay. The whole movie's been leading to this. Gets up into the lighthouse. It's like orgasmic almost. Then he screams massively.
Or he's orgasming.
It's one of the Well, it could be both.
It's probably both. Though,
it's probably both. Then he falls down the stairs. He sees something.
Yeah.
Tentacle monster. I don't know what.
No one. Yeah. They don't show.
You don't know. And then he falls down and then there's nothing else. And then they cut away to him later, right?
Yeah.
And
I don't know how he got out of the lighthouse from where he was.
He probably stumbled. In fact, I died from kerosene poisoning.
Then
probably.
But then he didn't have clothes on.
Yeah, well, like, yeah, because he's like, oh, you know, have you ever been drunk on kerosene, Mitch, and not wanted your clothes on? Everyone's been there.
I don't think that he's actually, okay, so the very last scene is him getting pecked by the birds.
And you're right, the bird did have one eye, because it mirrors what happened to him. He has one eye.
He has one eye, yeah.
And he's getting pecked in his innards. Now, we really skipped over the main plot point, is that if you kill the bird, it's bad luck.
Yeah.
And as soon as that bird dies is when the weather turns.
The wind changes.
And that's essentially why they can't be relieved, because the weather is not good enough for the replacements to even get there, right?
Yeah.
Do you think that was for real, or did you think that was... Because in The Witch, you're not sure if there's a supernatural thing until the very end.
Yeah, I think in this case...
you think it was supernatural?
I don't think it was supernatural.
Okay, you think it was just them... going crazy. I mean, they're paranoid.
I think
on
that
the
weather. I think the weather just happened to change.
Okay.
I mean, there is already a dead bird in the cistern. You know, did that bird actually die and get put in there? You know, I think there was already a dead bird.
Yeah.
If
you kill the bird, natural causes.
But how did it get in the cistern?
Well, could it be dead? You just throw it in.
Who threw it in though, Nate?
I'm saying, but you don't have to kill. If the bird's already dead, it might be okay.
My point is that Dafoe killed a bird already? I don't think he did.
I don't think he did. But yeah,
I think it's just a coincidence.
It's like there's those people who only eat food if it falls off a tree.
No.
Like, but if they pick it off, if they can't do that.
Because I thought
this is the distinction.
I thought Dafoe maybe put the seagull in the cistern, the dead one.
He wasn't
in part of an attempt to blame any bad thing on Pattinson.
Yeah, he was really looking for these superstitions and Poseidon smites and all kinds of shit.
Like, it's bad luck to not toast someone when they're cheersing. This is like a really annoying frat brother just hanging around. Like,
dude, you gotta butt chug, man. Everyone's butt chug. If you don't butt chug, I'm offended.
Yeah. I just toasted to your mom. Why aren't you toasting? It's like, Jesus.
Oh, God.
So, yeah, I don't know. I the ending's bizarre. I don't actually think that he was getting pecked by the birds at the end of it.
Okay, interesting.
I think that
just like The Witch.
Yeah, I think more a symbolism of maybe him being in hell or purgatory, or basically he's stuck there.
Oh, you know? I see what you're saying.
And that's why the bird that he sees
torment,
one eyed
torment,
and he's the same. Yeah.
Or you could take it as, hey, the supernatural, you fucked with it and then you got the horns.
Yeah. Well, because it really depends on what you think the light is in the lighthouse, right? Is the light
have magical qualities?
Well, is it supposed to be symbolism of like heaven or you know, the divine, right? Because here's a guy that's murdered ostensibly two people, that has drifted from job to job, that is, you know, I mean, by all rights, insane. Is the screaming at the end basically the light rebuking him, and that's why he's expelled and falls down and dies?
Saying.
You know,
but was Willem Dafoe worthy of the light all that time then, though? See, I don't know about that. That would be like it saying, oh, Willem Dafoe's fine.
Maybe not, but maybe it never opened up for Willem Dafoe. Like maybe he was just in there marveling at it, but he never got
saw a true form. I see.
Maybe. I
see
it's
what
hard.
You're saying.
Yeah. You make a good point, too. I get it. It's.
It's ambiguous.
Yeah.
On purpose. And the fact that we're talking about it means it's awesome.
Yeah. I mean, I definitely want to see it again because I want to see if I can piece some more of this stuff together.
Yeah.
You know, there's some other themes too. And there's a lot of like Jungian type stuff going on in there.
Sure.
But I mean,
Carl Jung, why not?
Why not? Well, he does a lot. I mean, I know he said in some interview I saw where he's like, oh yeah, I'm big in Carl Jung. Everything I do is Jungian.
when I had that goat impale that dude. Carl Jung, all the way, baby.
I mean, what'd you think of the ending?
It's
you were there with the full, like I was only there like four other people.
Yeah.
And we didn't talk about it afterwards. You were there the whole theater of film nerds.
Dude, everyone was going ballistic. Everyone loved it. This is I mean, if you are a film nerd, this is hitting you in, right in the wheelhouse.
Yeah.
Even if you're
less, it's hitting you right in the shark vagina.
It's a, well, it's a mermaid vagina.
Oh,
it's
did you see modeled what she, after a shark?
Did you see what that mermaid was wearing?
Jeez.
Nothing. She was wearing nothing.
No.
No, but yeah.
A lot of screaming.
Yeah. But yeah. Well, and at one point the mermaid tries to lure him, I think, to his death also. Yeah. No, but the yeah, I mean the ending in this particular screening, I mean, everyone just erupted. I mean, it was a totally different atmosphere. I would watch this with somebody else if you can.
Yeah.
Because this is a movie you want to talk about.
Yeah. Yeah. You've had to sit on this for several weeks.
Several weeks. It's like over a month and a half.
Oh God, has it really been that long? Yeah, you're right. You're right. Oh shit.
But yeah, it's a. I mean, this movie is very good. The acting. Yeah. I mean, like I said, the acting is just such a high quality. You feel like you're there. You don't even notice there's like huge black bars across the entire left and right of the screen. I mean, it's you're teleported into it, and it does a great job of living in that time period and taking you there, which is awesome.
Yeah.
Then when it ends, you're like, oh shit! Oh, it spiraled so amazingly. All the calamities that could possibly happen all happen, and then you were like, holy shit! What would the end mean? We don't know.
Yeah.
It's ambiguous, just like the witch ending. It's just like. Yep. I mean, where do we go from here? Who knows? End.
Yep.
So if you're looking for like a satisfying conclusion, you're not really getting that here.
Yeah.
But it's a nuts ride on the way there.
Well, listen, Nate, there are times in your life where you're waiting for your shift's over. You're waiting on your backup. You need to get out of there because you feel like you're losing your mind.
Yeah.
And you're banging some sweet, sweet shark. Mermaid.
Mind
strange. Huh?
It was really a mind mermaid. You're imagining
it. Yeah.
Unless the mermaid was real, which would have been awesome.
I mean, at least it didn't look like the actual wood statue that he's imagining. It looked like an actual like mermaid. Could you imagine just like weird, more curves. Like this is a larger version of that.
It's an ent from Lord of the Rings.
Like it looks like the Olmec from the Legends of the Hidden Temple. But listen, Nate, yeah, it could clearly be a lot worse.
Could be worse.
Not that bad.
For me, it's all about perspective.
It's what you make of it.
I don't know if it could be worse. This one is rough.
Yeah.
You are stuck with a douche from either direction. The movie's more from our appearances.
I suppose if there was an actual squid monster Cthulhu type person coming after you.
Yeah, but then the sweet release of death would have come earlier.
Well, true.
I mean, any movie where you're drinking kerosene purposefully. Ooh boy.
Yeah, this movie's normally, it's kind of like, that's kind of the cheap answer, but I think you're right in this case. I don't think there is anything. This is as bad as it's getting.
Well, it could be worse. It could be worse. You could have the mermaid be real, and then she breaks up with you.
Oh, that's Willem Dafoe's ex-wife that he left. Yeah,
I want to see.
Oh man, what if that was his ex-wife and Robert Pattinson's been sleeping with it?
I want to swim with other people.
I guess it could be worse if you're Robert Pattinson. You're about to fight him, and then Willem Dafoe's like. The leg injury was all a ruse, and he just starts kicking you all the kicks.
Goes right for the legs. Yeah. Yeah. But as I'm saying,
sweep
he
the
didn't
leg.
Practice the shadow kick. He didn't do the karate kid. He didn't do anything.
That's how it could have been worse. Well, Nate, look, this is, I mean, is that really a horror film? I don't know what to call it.
It's a psychological horror film.
I guess.
There's tentacle monsters. There's other things trying to kill you. There's all kinds of shit.
Well, so Nate, could this movie have worked as any other genre at all?
So the genre is psychological 1890s lighthouse horror. I'll never say those combination of words again.
Right.
Okay. Actually, this one isn't too bad. Imagine the lighthouse as a Western.
Okay.
So it's not a lighthouse.
So the alcohol stays. That's
the alcohol stays.
Done.
It's not a lighthouse. It's like a what? Like a very forward outpost.
Yeah.
A very remote outpost.
Yeah.
Maybe it's on like a mountain. You're on a mountain somewhere.
They're the sheriff for like a month.
Well, no, like something happens and like the town is like sacked by outlaws and they have to, they're the only two people left and they flee together up into the mountains and their rations start going away and they start, that actually could be good.
It is basically the same movie. I don't think he almost changed anything.
But instead of tentacle, so you have different lore now.
Yeah.
So no tentacle monsters, no sea.
So now you're doing more Native American mythology.
That's not co-op Native Americans anymore.
I'm just saying a lot more of the desert type of mythology and creatures.
You want it to be thinner, is what you're saying. Thinner.
No, the gypsy, I don't want someone
the gypsy woman thinner is them. That's what you. That's what you're telling.
No, because they're gypsy, not Native American.
You're telling. Oh, exactly. Exactly. I don't want either of those.
It's all right when it's gypsies. You can talk all sorts of trash when it's gypsies.
This is what I'm saying. No. So instead of what's in the Old West? What kind of legends we got in the Old West here?
The chupacabra.
Is that more West?
Not I don't really. Know.
Hey, what about what if he's instead of banging a mermaid, he's banging a Yeti?
We're up in the mountains. Yeti is not
up in the mountains, baby. Up in the mountains.
A Yeti, it would be at best a Bigfoot, and even then.
Oh, Bigfoot, yeah, okay, whatever, same thing.
Yeti's in the Himalayas. Man. Okay, come on now.
What's the difference?
One lives in the snow in the Himalayas, and one is hanging around the Appalachians. Difference?
Do they share a same ancestor? Jesus. okay, we got a Bigfoot sighting. It could be a Bigfoot. We could have some sort of, if you wanted to go in the Native American stuff, then you could really mess with some people.
Yeah.
But it's like every Stephen King thing. It's like, there's always a Native American something. Like, okay.
Fair. I'm not saying that the outpost is over an Indian burial ground. I'm just saying that some of their legends, maybe that's where you draw some of the mythology and the symbolism from.
Did you ever see the Walker, Texas Ranger episode where he basically goes on like a vision quest? This is a random question.
Is that what happens in this movie? They drink kerosene to go on a vision quest.
They do a bunch of shit ton of like just old school drugs, that are basically there. And he kills the horse. You kill a horse, that leads to the bad luck. Yeah,
or would it be a buffalo?
Yeah, no, all the buffaloes got murdered. So there's a lot of people with bad luck then. Right?
I guess. I don't know.
I mean, are we going witches here? Are we going witches?
No.
Is that what we're doing here?
No.
No?
No, you gotta do something different because you've already done witches.
I mean, I'm trying to think of an animal that really would, I don't know.
I mean, a coyote?
Yeah, like coyote.
Scorpions?
I mean, if it's the revenant, you could go with a bear.
Oh, yeah, bears could still work. Cougar or mountain lion? Yeah.
John Cougar Mellencamp. I don't know much about the man. Yes. We know more about Texas than we do about the Old West. That's for sure.
Yeah. The Old West is garbage. This is real.
I mean, I feel like we're more in the ghost territory. I feel like it's ghosts.
Yeah, ghosts could maybe be.
I feel like it's more of a ghost area at that point.
Because there's not enough cryptids in that.
This is kind of like you haven't seen the movie The Wind.
No,
it's okay. Or like Bone Tomahawk. It's like part of the, that's the Native American one, but The Wind is interesting. I don't recommend it, but it's real slow. Yeah. Even for me, it's slow. So, you know, it's bad. But yeah, I mean, it's like, it's not The Happening.
So what would
like
you call, this Western lighthouse?
So there's The Lighthouse.
I mean, right? It's just The Outpost.
Outpost.
Yeah.
Yeah. The Outpost. Yeah. That's the lodge was already taken. From another movie we saw at Fantastic Fest, which is coming out next year.
Now, does Willem Dafoe just have a crazy, like, Western accent?
That's what I'm saying. I feel like Willem Dafoe could crush this.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, Willem Dafoe with the spittoon just seems like a movie that needs to happen. Willem Dafoe needs to have a spittoon somewhere.
I mean, basically, it's Red Dead Redemption, the movie.
No. It's more secluded, right?
Yeah.
And then there's also, I mean, they lose the horse, right? Like, I feel like they have... I feel like in The Lighthouse, they're together. You have to be able to ride a horse somewhere.
Sure.
I feel like they have a general area. Then the horses go down. Then they're isolated.
Yeah.
Maybe it's a Donner situation.
Ooh,
oh. Yeah. Oh. Well, the Kerosene are supposed to be having our lanterns in our wagon that we have as our only shelter.
God,
but now we're drinking.
Nate.
What? Jesus.
The Oregon Trail.
That's a video game. It's called Oregon
Trail. I know, but what if this takes place on the Oregon Trail and they just get lost?
Yeah, that's essentially what I'm saying. Or they could be like fur trappers. Yep. I don't know, something.
Yeah, something. All right, well, look. We've talked a lot about this movie.
Outpost.
But Nate, what is your final cut?
Final cut.
This is a hard one.
Yeah.
Can I go second?
Sure. So that means I have to think more quickly.
Yes.
Yeah.
Tables.
Man, it's good. It's weird. I'm curious. Do you have what I gave The Witch?
Yes, I do. Okay, so let's talk about this. Where is this in terms of The Witch? Better, worse? Where are we talking?
Oh, man, it's about the same, truthfully.
Because you gave The Witch a 7.
Yeah, I'm between a 6 and a 7. I think I'm going to go 7 out of 10. Mermaid.
So this is just as good as Constantine.
Yeah.
They're two different movies.
two different experiences. This is, I mean, again, the rewatchability of it, I think, you know, is a big positive. It does drag a little bit at certain points. But I mean, I think that's just a symptom of it being just two people and just building tension. But the movie itself is very well done. You're not going to see anything really like it. It's very well acted. And again, there's a lot of things you can go down to the rap, you know, there is the surface level story, which I think is very easy to understand and assimilate. It's not like you're not going to walk out there going, what happened? I don't get it. The basic story is understandable,
but
there's a lot of stuff
you
can go down rabbit holes on.
Exactly.
So yeah, I think I'd give it the same 7 out of 10.
Now I'm debating on giving it the same ranking I gave Constantine, which is an 8. This is an 8.3 in IMDb right now.
Okay.
So people are still watching it, but it's real high.
Yeah.
But I think a little less people are seeing it because it's more of an art film.
Yeah.
A little bit less theater. I think The Witch got more of a wide release than this did.
Yeah.
For sure. Do we give this movie the same we gave Constantine for just polar opposite reasons?
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm going to do it. I'm going to give it an 8. I can't give it anything less than an 8. The acting is so good. Seagull murder. What does he say? Oh, the mermaid came on to me. Is that what he says to justify this?
No. God.
I don't know. But I mean, Willem Dafoe, Robert Pattinson, I mean, these are great actors. Yeah. Robert Pattinson is now in the category for me. He was in Good Time. I highly recommend watching Good Time. He's really good in that. He's been really good in a bunch of other things. This movie, I think, like, in my eyes, top of the top, actor-wise. He's so freaking good in this. It's stupid. I'm hoping he brings that to Batman, because then it might be one of the superhero movies I actually want to see.
Yeah.
That's not Blade or Constantine related.
Oh, my God. All right, well, that's going to wrap it up for this week's episode. Nate, where can they find us?
You can find us in all Lighthouse-related conversations at TX Podmasker on Twitter. Send us an email if you have, or a tweet if you have different people that you'd want to be in the Lighthouse, or general questions, or you want us to do a movie. Literally any of those. We are ready to take that in. Mitch is dying for Human Centipede. Just waiting.
God damn it, Nate.
So again, TexasPodcastMasker@gmail.com, at TX Podmasker on Twitter. We're on Facebook, Instagram, all your podcast platforms. We thank you for the 5-star reviews on iTunes/Apple Podcasts. I didn't screw up this time, Mitch. And give us 5-star review. Put Team Basement on there, and we'll do your movie.
Or the more correct, Teamatic.
That also is an option that is physically possible. Type it in the keyboard. Oh, but God. I mean, why would you want to do that? But yeah, no, we really appreciate it.
Because you want to be on the right side of history.
The thing is, you should have said it's the upside of history, and then the basements are the downside of history. But now that I've said it, you can't use it.
We
really appreciate it. We're getting a little more engagement, and we appreciate it. And thanks to all the Welshmen who are downloading our podcast. We think that's really tidy. That means great in Welsh. Okay, so thanks for listening again.
Yeah.
And the next two episodes that we're coming out with later this month are going to be a real treat. And get ready to rent some movies that are not available on any streaming service.
We are bringing you some real turkeys for this Thanksgiving season.
Exactly.
So, all right, well, that will wrap it up for this week. From all of us here at Texas Podcast Massacre, thank you so much for tuning in. And just keep telling yourself, it's only a movie. Good night.